Good evening, this is BelGeode, and we are back with some more X-Plane 11. So we're back here at the Ocean Reef Club Airport in Key Largo, Florida. And as you can see, things look slightly different. Most notably, when I parked, we weren't exactly sitting on gravel here. We were actually sitting on the tarmac. However, in the interim between episodes, I managed to download a nifty little freeware scenery for this airport. It really didn't add much because, honestly, in real life, there isn't much. But at least we were able to get gas. So now we can hop back into Huey and make for Miami and Fort Lauderdale, and we can wrap this trip up here. So first things first, go ahead and close the door. Much better, much quieter. Okay, and let me just take a cursory glance at all the instruments here, make sure we're good to go. Enzio looks like he's ready to go as well. All right, RPM is still low because we need to pull the throttle back up, so we'll do that in a second here. As you can see, we're up to 177. Let me get the GPS started here. Because I had to restart this flight, everything was turned off, so naturally I had to go through the entire startup process for you. Okay, GPS. Bingo. All right, it still says that we are trying to get to the airport, but we're already here. Okay, let me refresh your memory on our flight plan, and we will take it from there. Okay, so for the last two episodes, this will be the third episode, we've been doing a journey from Key West all the way up the chain of the Florida Keys, eventually ending up in Fort Lauderdale. As you can see, we are in Key Largo, which is actually the end of the Keys as we know it. Now, what we'll be doing for this journey is we're going to cross over Biscayne Bay and we're going to fly towards Miami. I might veer off a little bit because, as I'm sure you can see, there is a sports-related TFR, apparently some kind of football game or something, I don't know. And then, once we're finished taking a look at Miami, we will head north to Fort Lauderdale. Okay, so now we have an idea how we're going to wrap this up. We can put it back on the map and get rid of the GPS for the time being here. And we will definitely want to get that throttle up and running. Here we go. That should do the trick. We'll give it a second to get everything stabilized here. Want to make sure it's back up to about 100% RPM. That's one thing I will say about this helo. The governors definitely do their work. They keep everything in order. It's so ridiculously easy to fly. I hate to say it, but it's actually better than the DCS Huey in that regard because of the fact that we've got all these modern conveniences here that help us out. Okay, we are at 100%. Very nice, very nice. And I'll be setting the autopilot at some point in time here. I think what we're going to do, though, is we're going to fly it manually for a little bit. All right, switch the pedals here. Collective up, and here we go. We are off. Next stop, mainland Florida. Okay, so we'll take a quick look at the airport here. Like I said, they really didn't add too much to this airport. However, I don't think it really needs too much, because like I said, there's not much here. Now, I didn't mention this before, but there's actually two ways to get to this island. There is, of course, the overseas highway, which I showed you before. That's US 1. And the other way to get here is on a road called Card Sound Road, C-A-R-D, Card Sound Road. Personally, I think the better journey is the overseas highway over in that direction. However, if you take that road, you miss out on all this little residential area here, and of course, all the beautiful scenery just to the north of us here. Okay, so directly ahead, we've got mainland Florida, and pretty close to this location is going to be Homestead Air Reserve Base, and I'll point that out once we get closer to it. One of the things that the person who created this scenery also included was a nuclear power plant that is called the Turkey Point Nuclear Power Plant. So I'll show that to you once we get a little bit closer to it as well. In the meantime, let me go ahead and set us up on course here. I may just do a heading hold. Let me just see if I can line us up here. Okay, that looks like it's going to be as good as it'll get. This should be fine. We are now directly on course. I really should have changed my HSI, however, meh, we can live with it. Alright, I do need to come down on a vertical speed, however. I want to stick right about there. We'll bring it up to about 2,000-ish. We are at 1,600 right now. Okay, and nav is on. Okay, yeah, we're lined up. Very good, very good. Okay, as soon as we get to 2,000, I'm going to click on the altitude hold right about there. Ooh, on the money. Just off by 1 foot. I love it. I love it. Okay. So as I stated before, that is the Turkey Point Nuclear Power Plant, which is the biggest power plant in South Florida. Needless to say, that does power a great portion of the South Florida region, stretching from Florida City and Homestead on north towards like Miami and places like that. I don't remember just how damaged that was when Hurricane Andrew came through in 1992, but I will say that this whole area was pretty much freaking devastated when Hurricane Andrew came through. All right, let me get our speed up here. I'm thinking 120 should be good. We're not in a huge rush to get to the busy airspace that is Miami. Of course, since this is X-Plane, I have the AI traffic for the most part turned off, so we really don't have to worry about running into any extra aircraft all over the place. And get our lights back on too. Okay, so far we're looking good, and ahead you should see the city of Homestead. Now, I am not 100% certain if this is modeled in Drzewiecki's Miami or if this is W2XP that we're looking at. However, that area there should be Key Biscayne, if I'm not too mistaken, and that is a part of Drzewiecki's Miami. So, we're going to have some pretty impressive scenery coming up here. Let me just see if I can see downtown Miami. There it is! Yep, that is downtown Miami. Trust me, we'll get a closer look, however. We have some buildings popping in there. It's to be expected. Ah, there we go. That's the big commercial district there. Can't tell you how many times I've been to that town. Let me just tell you. Hey, there's even some cruise ships off in the port in Miami there. That's pretty cool. Wow, that's one thing I've got to say about Drzewiecki that never ceases to amaze me, is just how much he puts into any scenery that he does. Now, if only I could get him to do Pittsburgh. I know I keep saying that, but Eventually, somebody's got to do it, please. All right, I'm going to change course here a little bit. Go. Okay, so I've got the nav off. I might just use the heading hold, as I had mentioned before. So I want to kind of go off course and show you a little bit of Miami Beach, South Beach, that whole area there, because honestly, I think that's some of the highlights of Miami. The rest of it is just urban sprawl, seriously. Okay, so let's see. If I swing out to the right a bit, that should do the trick. Yeah, I'm thinking this should be good. I'll adjust accordingly as well. Alright, as we get closer to the mainland, we should be able to see Homestead Air Reserve Base, and I'll tell you a little bit about it here. It is the home to the 482nd Fighter Wing, which are F-16Cs, or Charlies. In 1992, of course, Hurricane Andrew, as I mentioned earlier, had come through, and it destroyed this base. It was so sad to see. There were like F-16s all flipped over and everything. As a matter of fact, look to the left. Hold on a second. We'll do it this way. Yeah, look through the window there. You will see Homestead Air Reserve Base right there. Now, I don't know if it's updated scenery in X-Plane. I don't see any F-16s there, which I didn't really expect to. But I also don't see any buildings at all, so I'm not sure if that is something that is just part of the default X-Plane scenery or if it's included with Drzewiecki. I want to say it's not, however. I think it's too far south for him to have included it. But suffice to say, what they did do is they rebuilt the airbase and reopened it back in 1994 as an air reserve base. Okay, so we've got the areas of Kendall coming up ahead there, and like I said, we've got Key Biscayne on this side. I'm thinking what we're going to do is overfly Key Biscayne, and then we'll just follow Miami Beach north, and as soon as we reach where the port of Miami is, I'll hang a left. All right, let me make sure everything's looking kosher. Yeah, now would be a great time to set my heading. Just give me one second here. I've never actually tried the heading hold on this thing, so now would be a good test for it. Alright, heading is 45. I might want to go a little bit more to the right, I'm thinking. Set our course while I'm at it here. I want to point it more towards the airport, so that should be, what, about 3, 4, 5, something like that. Yeah, I'm just kind of looking over at the GPS here to get a better idea. I want to say that should be pointing directly to the airport. Of course, it's going to be inaccurate in a few minutes, but you know, we'll deal with that accordingly. All right, so next stop is going to be Key Biscayne. And let me just tell you that Key Biscayne is like a blast out of my past. That is a slice of my childhood right there. As we get a little bit closer, I will fill you in on all the details. Looks like we've got not too far off. Not too far off at all. Probably about 8 miles directly ahead. Key Biscayne is home to Crandon Park, which is a county park. Now, I don't know if it still has it there, but I remember as a kid, When my family would take me down to Crandon Park, there used to be like a railroad. I guess it was a model scale railroad, but it was big enough that you could actually sit on there, and you could literally drive around the park in these trains. And I always thought that was the absolute coolest thing. Growing up, I really wanted to be like a train engineer before I wanted to be a pilot. What in the hell is that? Is that a building? Okay then, I'm not sure what's causing that. I highly doubt it's Drzewiecki's scenery, so it's gotta be W2XP or something. That's wild. Just random buildings floating around there. Anyway, welcome to Key Biscayne and the beginnings of Miami. You can see Crandon Park directly ahead. It's in the middle part of the island. The southern part of the island is another park. That is Bill Bagg's Cape Florida State Park, which honestly I don't remember ever visiting there when I was a kid. But the central area, that would be the town or city, if you will, of Key Biscayne. Technically, I think they still have it listed as a village. It looks like it's a lot more people to be considered a village here. All right, I'm going to go ahead and take us off of autopilot here. And we're going to do some manual flying as we check out the town. Now the next island off to the left is Virginia Key. Virginia Key, its claim to fame, I guess you would say, is it's the home of the Miami Seaquarium. So all the dolphins, and I want to say they used to have killer whales and so on and so forth, but I think they're most known for the dolphins, in particular Flipper, way back in the day. I don't even know if Flipper is still alive anymore. I don't know if the Seaquarium is still a big thing in Florida, because with the advent of animal rights and so on and so forth, really people have been kind of poo-pooing on a whole Seaquarium and aquarium type thing. So I'm not even sure if it still sees, you know, a fair amount of people anymore. Just beyond Fisher Island, which is directly below us, is one of my favorite places in South Florida. That is Miami Beach. More to the point, South Beach. Now, you've probably heard of South Beach from like MTV and stuff like that. Pretty much you can see anything you want in South Beach. It's all there. But anyway, my connection to South Beach is, I don't know if I told you all, but I used to be a musician. I actually got my start in heavy metal. I was a vocalist for a death metal band by the name of Malicious Damage. That's how I got the nickname Drucifer for many years. In fact, people still call me that to this day. We played a crap ton of gigs down here in South Beach. So I'm really glad to see that Drzewiecki did South Beach some justice, because I can actually recognize a lot of these roads, and I can tell you where most of the clubs are that we played down in this little neck of the woods here. So yeah, good times. Definitely good times. All right, let's head inland here. We'll go past Port of Miami and downtown Miami, and then we'll take a quick run out to Miami International Airport. I think it was one of the Ace Combat games. Might have been Assault something or another. Assault Horizon or Assault Event. I don't even remember the name of it. But I just remember that it featured Miami as part of the main storyline. And that was like one of the last times that I recall seeing Miami pretty accurately depicted in a video game. Of course, this is a flight simulator, so it's held at a very high standard as opposed to just your average quote-unquote video game. So I'm really glad that Drzewiecki did do this particular scenery. I don't know how old it is, but I do know that he did a phenomenal job on it, because I do recognize a lot of these places that we're flying over right now. Directly ahead of us is Miami International Airport. So like I said, we're gonna take a quick peek at that, and then we will head north to our final destination of Fort Lauderdale, which is of course another add-on scenery that I have installed here, but I'll explain a little bit more on that as we get closer to the airport. For now, we are on a direct course for, what is that? Runway, I wanna say it might be 27 left, if I'm not too mistaken. I know all the runways here are like east to west, almost directly east to west. I'll have to look it up on Sky Vector in a second here. I could be wrong on that. Yeah, according to Sky Vector, that is in fact runway 27. It's neither left nor right. The other side of the airport should have two runways, so I believe it's 26 left and 26 right. But yeah, we definitely have 27 directly ahead of us. So we're going to use that for our approach, and then we'll swing across on the crosswind runway to get a closer look at the airport. The crosswind runway should be runway 30 or 30. All right, let's bring her down a bit, and we'll take a look at Mr. Drzewiecki's handiwork. Welcome to Miami International Airport, which is considered the primary gateway to Latin America. The largest airline that flies in here is American Airlines, so you might say this is one of their homes. This airport is considered probably about the 10th busiest airport in the United States. So it's second to places like Chicago or Atlanta or whatnot. But there can be no mistaking, as far as international flights, the only airport that takes in more international flights on a daily basis would be JFK in New York. So if you happen to be traveling anywhere in like the Caribbean or Central or South America, there's a really good possibility you're going to need to go through Miami. Just north of Miami International Airport is the city of Hialeah, often dubbed Little Cuba, and with good reason. In 1980, the Mariel boat lift was a mass emigration of Cubans that left Cuba and ended up settling here as refugees. In the process, they managed to create a very strong community that's part and parcel of everything that you think about when you think about South Florida. Not to mention, the food and drink down here is absolutely to die for. And they still have a yearly festival called Calle Ocho that if you ever get the chance, you have to come down and see. Now, up ahead, we have Golden Glades and North Miami, as well as North Miami Beach. And then further beyond that, where those skyscrapers are, that would be Hollywood, Florida. Now, technically, Fort Lauderdale International Airport sits right in between the cities of Fort Lauderdale and Hollywood. Hollywood also has a special significance to me because after I had gotten out of singing heavy metal, I had actually started a world fusion band by the name of Dionysus, and that was one of the places that we ended up playing a lot in the South Florida region. As a matter of fact, the name that I currently use for my YouTube channel, BelGeode, originally started as my stage name with the band Dionysus. We all had stage names. So we're going to be taking a look at Hollywood really quick, and then I'm going to take us out to the coast over by Hallandale Beach, where I still have some really good friends that live there. Not surprisingly, one of the former singers for Dionysus still lives in Hallandale Beach. So we're going to be passing by her apartment and all of the other high-rise buildings that dot the coastline there. And then we're going to continue heading north to Fort Lauderdale International Airport, which really should be a hop, skip, and a jump away from there. The closer we get to the shore, you're going to notice the bodies of water get a little bit larger. That is the intracoastal waterway, which is one of the primary avenues to get people in and out of Fort Lauderdale and Hollywood. It sits right around near Hallandale Beach, and it travels north and actually cuts into the New River, which is more a canal rather than a river. But the New River is the major river that goes through Fort Lauderdale. So the thing about all the areas that basically are bordered by the intracoastal waterway is the fact that the property value is through the roof. This is where you're going to find all of those multi-million dollar homes from all the movie stars and the sports figures and musicians and everybody who's decided to make South Florida a part of their home. This is essentially where they live. It's right on the water, and they have like their multi-million dollar yachts and everything. Now, in that direction, that is Aventura. And Aventura is home of the Aventura Mall, which just about everybody who's coming in from the Caribbean and so on, they end up going there. That's one of those high-dollar malls. Now, on the other side, we should start seeing Fort Lauderdale and some of the suburbs surrounding it. I want to say over there should be where my college was. I went to Broward College. I was an art major, so that should be right there. The airport should not be too far off from there, however. Let's see if I can find it. You know what? There it is, right behind Enzio. Excuse me there, Enzio. Sorry to, like, get in your personal space there. But that would be Fort Lauderdale International Airport. So as you can see, we are currently going downwind, and my big plan is to take you over the beachfront, where we are going to hang a left, and that'll be our base leg to pass all these multi-million dollar places, as well as the high-rise condominiums that people insist on living in, even though we're in the middle of a hurricane area. Go figure. Can you imagine the price for insurance in any of these buildings that you're seeing along the coastline here? It is through the roof, pun intended. But yet, people still flock here, and people still want to retire here. So yeah, as you can see, if the demand is there, the supply will follow. This area is also home to the snowbirds, which, if you're a Floridian, just the mere utterance of that term can probably put you into post-traumatic stress disorder. There are two seasons in Florida. There is summer and there is tourist season. And in the wintertime, all the people that have homes in the north, they decide to come down to Florida and check into their condominiums and basically chill out here until it gets warm enough for them to go back up north. So hence the term snowbirds. I love this stretch of beach. This is one of my favorite places to go to because it's got band amphitheaters, it's got restaurants, bars, and all the souvenir shops you could possibly want. So if you are a visitor to South Florida, chances are, this area is where you're going to end up at some point. flight path that I'm taking here is actually a lot more typical than you might imagine. This flight path is often used for those planes that are dragging banners, and they'll basically run south to north or occasionally north to south along the beach to advertise whatever the heck it is that they're advertising. There are a lot of helicopters that will also fly along this path, in particular like the Coast Guard and so on. We're coming up to one of the last of the major landmarks that we need to look for before we make our turn to final and come into Fort Lauderdale International Airport, or Fort Lauderdale Hollywood International Airport, I should say. And what I'm talking about here is Port Everglades. As the name might state, it is the largest port in Fort Lauderdale and the Hollywood area. You've got a lot of the cargo ships that come in, and actually, fun fact, whenever the Navy has their fleet week, usually the aircraft carriers will dock there and will allow people to get on board so they can have a glimpse of what life is like for our boys and girls in uniform that have to live on these floating cities for months at a time. Of course, needless to say, that was quite possibly one of the fondest memories that I have as a child, is getting to be on an aircraft carrier. So we've come up to the last landmark that we need, which was Dania Beach and, of course, Port Everglades. So we're going to start heading in towards Fort Lauderdale International Airport. What I'll do is I'll take us down the southernmost runway, similar to how we did in Miami, and then we will kind of make that right-hand turn and end up landing on the north side of the airport, where all the cargo flights come in and so on and so forth. So buckle up, folks. We're coming in. Okay, so here is our final stop. As you can see, we've got FedEx over here. UPS should also be along this side, as well as Amerijet, which has special significance for me because my dad used to work for Amerijet as an airframe mechanic. So I remember this side of the airport quite well. We are going to park close to the Amerijet hangars, so you can probably see that rather large hangar directly ahead. I'm hoping to put her down right on the spot. And then that should do it for us today. So I sincerely hope you've enjoyed my little three-part journey from Key West all the way here to Fort Lauderdale. If I had to drive, it would probably take me several hours, like anywhere between 4 and 6 hours to do the trek that we just did. But luckily, we've got the good old Huey, so it's taking us considerably less time. Alright, let me see if I can get her a little bit closer to the line here. It's not going to be on the line, but I don't think it matters because there ain't nobody here but us. Okay, so that is it. We are down, and all I need to do now is just go ahead and get everything turned off. Okay, so we'll go ahead and get the throttle down, and we'll wait for everything to spool down before we start turning off engines 1 and 2. And I think I'll probably get some of these lights off while I'm at it here, so we'll turn off the position lights, or the nav lights if you prefer. Anti-collision is also off. Okay, I think we're about ready to start turning off some engines here. So let's see, we'll go ahead and start with engine number 2. Yeah, it looks like everything's down far enough, so I shouldn't have any problems turning it off here. Okay, engine 2 is now spooling down, so we'll go ahead and get the fuel cut off, boost pump, fuel transfer, all of that is off. There we go, everything's going to zero, so we'll turn the governor off and the particle separator. Okay, engine 2 is dead. Perfect! Absolutely perfect. Okay, and then we're ready for engine number 1. You know what? I should probably turn off the generator first. So there we go. Generator number 2 is off. I think that's all I need to do before turning off engine number 1. So we'll go ahead and do that real quick here. Should probably kill the landing lights, so we'll go ahead and put that down. We'll retract the lights. Okay, now we're ready for engine number 1. There we go. 1 is spooling down, so we'll go ahead and kill the fuel. Boost pump. Alright, governor, particle separator, good deal. Okay, so the only thing left to do is the generator. We'll turn that off. Inverters we still need to turn off, and of course we need to stop our rotor, but we need to wait for that to spin down enough for me to pull the rotor brake. So, while I'm waiting for all of that to happen, now would be the perfect time to thank you all for watching. This has been BelGeode. I have been flying in X-Plane 11, and our chariot for this three-part journey has been the X-Trident Bell 412, which is PAYWARE, and the link is below. I highly recommend you pick up this helicopter if you want an awesome rendition of the Huey. Okie dokie, folks. Oh, you know what? Before we go, we should probably say goodbye to Enzio. So goodbye, Enzio. We will see you next time, sir. Have yourself a great day. And I guess I can turn the rotor brake off. And we also need to kill those inverters and the battery. All right, so if you've enjoyed what you've seen, please feel free to give me a like. Don't forget to subscribe, and I will catch you next time when we will be back in Pennsylvania. Ciao!